Call 248-538-7474. 248-538-7474.
FM 88.1 WHPR, Highland Park.
The following program does not reflect the views and opinions of the station, its advertisers, management, or sponsors.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring to you a special announcement.
SOS Graphics and Printing, your source for quality, affordable printing. We offer business cards, brochures, flyers, labels, and tickets.
This is a journey which along the way will bring to you new color, new dimension, new value.
Innovative logo design, church bulletins, obituaries, and more. For more information, 313-342-2166. 313-342-2166.
In addition, SOS also provides technical support for your computer and telephone repair needs, as well as your internet service. You can count on the staff at SOS.
Are you looking for quality used tires and rims? Do you need your tire repaired? Love Tires, a staple in our community, located at 18070 Mount Elliott, just north of Nevada. Love has quality tires and rims. Open Monday through Saturday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Love Tires has special offers for seniors. If you have any questions, 313-892-7771. Love Tire, a sponsor of a scriptural discussion with the Son of Man and a community meeting with the Son of Man. At Love Tires, our slogan is, let's work together. Love Tires at 18070 Mount Elliott. That's Love Tires.
Are you at the end of your rope? If so, the Hodo Show and The Other Viewpoint are the perfect combination for the very best in radio music and some of the most in-depth topics that affect you. Every Sunday from 10 p.m. to midnight, right here on your community radio station, 88.1 WHPR. It's cheaper than therapy. Remember, I'm Hodo. Who are you? The Son of Man Speaks magazine is a tradition of the Muhammad Speaks newspaper set up by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The Son of Man Speaks magazine informs, teaches, and brings you news with a fresh perspective. The Son of Man Speaks magazine keeps you on top of the teachings of the Son of Man. The Son of Man Speaks magazine is the official magazine of the new Nation of Islam. For your subscription, 313-342-2166. That's 342-2166. The Son of Man Speaks magazine is dedicated to you becoming free indeed.
These are the locations where you can find the Son of Man Speaks magazine. 90s Knowledge Cafe, 12511 Woodward in Highland Park. Fish King Restaurant, 20351 Conan. Love's Tire, 18070 Mount Elliott. Fudge's Unisex Salon, 11330 Woodward. Steve's Produce Plus, 4650 Conan. Taylor's Afro Shop, 15354 Livinoy. The Black Hole Collective, African Collectibles, 12521 Woodward in Highland Park. The Marathon Gas Station, 15903 Woodward in Highland Park. Truth Bookstore, inside of the Northland Mall. Sisters Braid 2, with the very best in quality braids for you. Located at 17600 West 8 Mile in Southfield. Remember, these are the locations where you can pick up your copy of the Son of Man Speaks magazine today. To get a subscription delivered directly to you or as a gift for a family member or a friend, locally, 313-342-2166. That's 342-2166. Or nationally and internationally, 601-786-9788. That's 601-786-9788 for your copy of the Son of Man Speaks magazine.
All tithes and offerings belong to the Lord. Not the church, not the mosque, not the temple, not the synagogue, not the pastor, not the preacher, not the evangelist, not the imam, not the rabbi, not the minister, or the priest. All tithes and offerings belong to the Lord, and the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath day. To send your tithes and offerings directly to the Lord, log on to www.thenewnationofislam.com. That's thenewnationofislam.com. And look for the icon so that you can send your tithes and offerings by credit card, debit card, and checks. You can also send your tithes and offerings by wire transfer directly from your bank account. This is the name on the account so that you can send your funds. Muhammad's Temple, the Jefferson Bank, Fayette, Mississippi, 39069. That's 39069. The routing number is 065-303-056. That's 065-303-056. The account number is 84011. That's 84011. Remember, all tithes and offerings belong to the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, are you tired of reading your Holy Scripture and really not understanding what you've read? And if you're reasonably sure, have you ever tested that what you feel you know that may have a different view than your own? Then let's talk to one another. Let's reason with one another on a scriptural discussion with the Son of Man. A live broadcast Sundays at 12 noon, Wednesdays and Fridays at 9 p.m. So why don't you call in and let's discuss the Holy Bible, and if you have one, the Holy Qur'an, and come to an agreement about the Holy Scripture and their true meaning. So tune in to a scriptural discussion with the Son of Man every Sunday at 12 noon and Wednesdays and Fridays at 9 p.m. right here on TV 33 and 88.1 FM WHPR. You can call in on the air or off the air at 868-0351, 868-0342, and 868-4336. Of course, the area code is 313. That's 868-0351, 868-4336, and 868-0342.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful, the Truthful, and the Most Just, I greet all of you within the sound of my voice with the greeting words of peace from the Lord of the world. Allah, Salaam Alaikum. We are going to be having a guest this evening, Dr. Cherry Jones, who came into some national and international attention because he threatened to burn the Holy Qur'an. Many people have that profess themselves to be Muslims wanted to know why we would give him a forum. For they don't feel he should be allowed to express his points of view. I was told we got some blogs, was it, that people wanted to know why I would give a forum to what they called a bigot. And what really, if you look at the term bigot, then you would know that the mere fact that Dr. Jones wants to come into this forum, and even when he went on CNN, if nothing else, he showed you that he's not a bigot. He felt that his position was justifiable, and the thing that you do, you remember I told you many times that I would prefer an honest enemy above a dishonest friend. That's just another way of saying if a man, that's what you heard a lot from black people in America. Especially, I know I did as I was growing up. And mostly after, well, I would say after I reached my late teens, some of the older brothers that I used to hang around, they say I prefer the southern white man over the other one any day. Because at least with the southern white man, if he didn't like you, he told you. And if he did like you, he didn't care who knew it. And he would, he was what he was. And anyone that is truthful loves another person who is truthful, even if they don't, even if the person takes a position that is contrary to you. You have a starting point when a person is truthful with you about why they don't like you. Do you understand? So, when I first saw on the news where they were saying that Mr. Jones, Dr. Jones, was going to burn those Holy Qurans, you remember what I said. He had a right. If he bought them, if he wanted to burn them, that's his business. Now, this world is filled with hypocrisy. You just saw an example of it, how the, I mean, like Mr. Weiner, since he's been in the news. Now, they own Mr. Weiner because he was sending pornographic, lewd images. Yet, they got websites on there. I done been to some of them. They completely nude people. Do you not see the hypocrisy there? You can turn, I got DirecTV. I don't subscribe to that channel, but it is on there. Playboy. And them 296, I mean, wait a minute, 596, 592, and all them. And they put that stuff all out there from the time you young till now. They got whole communities where people walk around naked. Nudist colony. And they want to get out there and try to make that man look like he's doing something that's just unheard of. You got men wanting to marry men in this country. I'm not trying to justify what he did. I'm telling you that you ain't in no position to pass no judgment on nobody. Bunch of hypocrites. And so there's hypocrites
in the government, as you see. Hypocrites on the police force. You know, a hypocrite is somebody who pretends to be about something that they really ain't about. You remember the movie Serpico? It wasn't actually a movie. It was a documentary called Serpico. It was a bunch of crooked police in New York, and he was trying to be honest, and they set him up and shot him. And you remember that? No, you don't remember, huh? I look at something other than Star Trek. So I'm trying to show you there's hypocrites everywhere. And the Holy Quran teaches us to slay them where you find them. But it wasn't talking about physically killing the people. The way you do away with hypocrisy, you can't kill hypocrisy by killing the person who's a hypocrite. Because in the first place, the real person, a bullet won't kill. Have you not heard and said, as a man thinking in his heart, so let him be? Flesh is not a hypocrite. Flesh is obedient to whatever mind and is faithful to every any mind that goes in and inhabits. Even if that mind is insane, flesh obeys it. Then why punish the flesh for what the flesh didn't have no control over? Who is he that judgeth another man's servant? Now, so I'm trying to show you. I know why Dr. Jones wanted to burn the Qur'an. I knew why the minute that I heard it and saw it. You know, you get all up in arms because if you don't want people to wrong you, what should you practice toward people? Not wronging them? You remember when them Twin Towers got hit by them airplanes and whatnot, even though to this day, nobody with an ounce of sense believed that that was done from the outside. But we ain't gonna even go there. Remember when CNN showed the people over there praising that in the quote-unquote Muslim world, some parts of it? People was given hoorays for that thing. How many times have you seen American flags being burned in different parts of the world? See, you don't understand something. Let me explain something to you. Caucasian people love their flag like you do the Quran, or like you claim you do. And even these who claim to love the flag, if they truly love the flag, they would not condone any misrepresentation of what that flag's supposed to stand for. And those who claim to love the Holy Quran would not do anything that is against what that book's supposed to represent, which is righteousness. But you want to get angry when someone burns that which is dear to your heart. But when you burn something that's dear to other people's heart, you don't feel nothing. You say, good form. Do you know from the time I was a little boy, they may not do it no more. But I remember when I was a little boy in elementary school, when we got to school from kindergarten up, before we started class, the class would stand, and there was a flag someplace in the classroom. And everyone would stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. And you were taught to say, with your hand over your heart, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now, it's strange, I still remember that. And they ain't said it and I don't know when. But every little white child, every American child, has to learn that pledge. And in this country, you know, I remember when some hippies, remember the hippie movement? One of them had made him some pants out of the flag. And do you know they had to go to trial about it. Had a big old to-do about that. You don't put our flag on your behind, man. That's what he was, you know, and this was a white boy did this. You know why? It summed up. What was that poet that, you know, it was a lawyer that came up with the poem that became the national anthem. The first verse of it became the national anthem. Fort McHenry. During that fight, that lawyer, he was, they say he was about 35 years old when he did that. Y'all know about all of this. I'm glad. I'm trying to show you, if you're going to attack somebody, if you're going to say that someone is did you a wrong, you better make sure that you come and did something to provoke that. These people don't play, they don't play games. Do you know what their motto was in war? And still is? The flag don't touch the ground. I don't know if the law is still there, but if they see you put the American flag on the ground, you go to jail in America. If New Haven, and I don't know if it's that strict now, but that's to show you how much they treasure their flag. So when they see people who call themselves Muslims, doing things that even the Holy Qur'an forbids, where the Holy Qur'an said, abuse not those whom they call on besides Allah, lest they, in ignorance, abuse Allah. Oh, you say, I ain't did nothing but burn a rag. It's more than a rag to him. The Bible says, if eating meat will offend my brother, I won't eat it in front of him. I can abstain from that rather than cause offense or cause him to stumble over something I did. The way of peace, they have not known. You say, well, you justifying him? No, I'm not justifying anything. I'm not justifying you burning that American flag. And two wrongs ain't never made a right. But I'm trying to show you that you blaming somebody else for what you set in motion. To show you how serious they take their flag. You'll notice before any baseball game starts, before any basketball game starts, before any football game starts, before any major thing that go on in their world, them sports events and all of that, what do? They stand for what? For the singing of the national anthem. Well, what does that tell you? If you're going to take them people's flag and do that with it, you know that you are hurting them. You know, it bothers them for you to do that. You know, I know how it feels for somebody to treat you wrong and then forbid you to say, ouch. Forbid you to cry out that you've been done wrong. We've been suffering that for 400 and some years. And we condemn the ones who did that to us. So now, when we get up to a position, shall we become that which we condemn? I mean, if he took his money and bought up every Qur'an that was in a bookstore and took them out there right after he bought them and took them on his property or wherever he got control of or that they ain't going to get him for doing it and set them on fire, whose business is that? How has that hurt your faith? And the sad part, here this man sitting up in this country, I know about how he feels. That's the good thing about having been walked on and everything and mistreated. You can empathize with people. You can understand where they're coming from. And then to see you, who rejoice over that, some of your citizens coming to his country and demanding rights that flag supposedly represents after you don't have no respect for it. Yeah, he mad. He has a right to be. And believe me, that flag ain't been no great thing to me. As a slave, that flag was flying over this country when my father was being mistreated. But my teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, some of his last words to me was to take the blame off of them because he knew I'm the judge. And he said, don't blame them for what by nature you had a hand in putting in them. He also said, now remember, their flag is still flying over America. Honor and respect the man, because he still have his flag. You know, even to this day, I have my own national anthem now. The flag of the new nation of Islam has a national anthem, and it sends goose pimples on me when I hear it sung. But when I hear the Star Spangled Banner, I can't help it. I can't help it the way I was raised. I still feel something when that song is sung. That's the one thing you can see. There's certain things when it has been embedded in you, you can't just discard it because it has become part of you. I want you to listen, and this will help you to understand where that man is coming from. Just a moment. Oh, I'm supposed to. Oh, I have to call Dr. Jones here. I'll let you hear that later. We'll get Dr. Jones on the phone. Yes, Dr. Jones?
Yes, hi.
How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you?
Oh, I'm not complaining.
Good.
Dr. Jones, we are on the air now, and we are on the internet, and we also on broadcast up in Detroit.
And before we get into our discussion with each other, would you like to take a few minutes to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. My name is Jerry Jones. I am the founder and president of Stand Up America Now, and I also was the pastor of Double World Outreach Center. In the meantime, the church has been turned over to Luke Jones.
Is he your relative or what?
That is my son, yes.
Oh, okay. Now, you know, you came into national prominence for threatening to burn some Holy Qur'an. And, you know, lots of times people hear something and they run with it without even understanding what it's about. And so I'm not the person who likes to keep conflict going. If a person is honest about why they dislike you, then if you want to, they are giving you a means to make peace with them by correcting something that they did not appreciate. And so I, you know, I don't know what your main reason for feeling like you need to burn the Quran, which is you have the right to do if that's what you want to do. But I do care if something that people who claim to be what I am are the reason that you wanted to do that. Because I'm a Muslim. And I don't subscribe to the term Muslim terrorist. That's like saying dry water. I mean, there's no such thing as dry water. There's no such thing as a person who submits to God going around trying to terrorize people. That's not what religion is about. And so I want you to be able to express, if you would, I would like to know what that was, what motivated that sentiment that you feel that you need to express your displeasure about something by burning Quran. And you feel free, if you would, tell us.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I guess you're talking, of course, about you're referring to our 9/11 event. International Burn of Quran Day. That actual event was scheduled as a protest. We are well aware that the burning of the Quran is insulting to many Muslims around the world, especially those who are against terrorism, or especially those who claim to be peaceful Muslims. We tried to make it very clear that country, this aspect of Islam, we are very much against. But as I said, if they have come here to honor and obey the Constitution of the United States, and to have it as the highest authority in their mind or in their life, and not the Quran or Sharia, then of course they are welcome here in America. If that is not their intentions, then they will definitely have problems here.
Well, before I comment on that, I don't want you to feel that you have to rush to say what you have to say. I'm not a person who likes conflict. I've learned that no one who says they love conflict can, in the next breath, say that they love God. That is not what Islam is about. Now, as far as what you have come to, or what the world has come to view as Islam, it's not really Islam. If you know anything about the history of Islam in America, then you have to bear me witness that the first introduction to Islam in America was not done from anybody overseas. The first introduction to Islam on the shores of North America was by the Nation of Islam under the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the officials of this country came to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the FBI, and some of the others, and they told him, he said, well, you know, those over there in the East, they don't agree with you. And the messenger, he answered, he said, that's to be expected. He said, because they have never heard this before. He said, but they too will have to submit to what Allah has revealed to us. For they have been lost in their understanding. You hear term Muslim now, and it's immediately associated with someone in Arabia or someone in Pakistan or someone overseas. But there was a time when you heard the term Muslim, and even in your dictionary, you will discover that the definition of Muslim is described as a member of the Nation of Islam, which tells you that the first introduction to Islam that white America or black America or any America citizen, American citizen as a whole, any group, the first introduction to Islam was from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam. And we may have been accused of many things, but we were never accused of terrorism. And at the time that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad left here, you noticed that the mayor of Chicago, Mayor Richard Daley, who definitely had some respect from the presidents even in this country, he declared Elijah Muhammad Day in the city of Chicago. And this was done in most of the major cities because the history of Muslims in America has always been peaceful, even to this day. We don't carry weapons. We were forbidden to carry them by Allah's messenger. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad told us, he said that Allah said not to pick up so much as a penknife. That if you believe in God, and if you don't mean people any harm, well then you don't need to be walking around carrying weapons. If you trust God, let God defend you. Now that sounds spooky to people, especially in a world where people just run over you if you don't have some means to protect yourself. Well, that was allowed for a time, but that day is gone now. God himself is with us today, and he's with us to respect people
give people the same honor and respect that we would like people to give us. And believe me, I mean this from my heart, Doctor. I do not wish you or your people any ill. I speak for Muslims all over the planet. Anyone that claims to be Muslim, whether they like it or not, I speak for Muslims. And anyone else that comes up talking about they speaking for Muslims, he's speaking for himself. He's not speaking on behalf of Jesus, Moses, David, Solomon, and all of those righteous ones who submitted to God. That's what Muslim means. It means one who submits to God. That's in the dictionary. And if we are not one who submits to God, even the Constitution that you're quoting, you notice the Constitution says, Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment nor the prohibiting of religion. I mean, the Pledge of Allegiance says one nation under God. I would say this to what you were saying. If they want to change the Constitution, then the Constitution has a way that you can go about doing so, but it's certainly not by force. It must be by bills and the people of the country agreeing that that's what they want done. So I don't say that I don't want the word of God as the final word. I'd be a hypocrite to say that. Certainly I want God to be the one that have the final word. But the problem with that is you got too many people running around here talking about God is speaking through them, and they lie. And that's what I want to put a stop to. I know what I just said offends many who claim to be Muslim. But it's mighty strange. I offer them $20,000 in my life. If they don't have to look for me, all they have to do is come in here and prove me wrong. If I'm not the only one to speak for Muslims, then I messed up. But I am the only one who can speak for us. And I do so not as arrogant, as an arrogant, self-important zealot, but I do so as the humble servant of Allah and of the people. And it serves no purpose for me to do evil to you just because you did evil to me. The scripture says, do not evil for evil. You repel evil with good. But at the same time, when you saw your flag burned by those who claimed to be Muslim, I know about how you felt. When you saw people acting happy over what they deemed to be a terrorist attack on America, I know how you felt. No civilized person looks at another person losing family members and losing loved ones, gets out in front of those people, and as good as says, good for you. And then get angry because the person that you insulted like that you showed that they, you get insulted. Now, you are insulted because the man decided he going to burn that which you trash? No, I'm not. But I'm saying this, you and I, we can put a stop to this kind of foolishness. We can practice what these books teach. The Bible says, as you would that men do to you. Not as men do to you, but as you would like them to do to you. Do that to them. That's why I'm in here with you, and that's why I accepted you to come on here. And anything else you have that you want to say, you're welcome to say it. But I don't want you to think that Muslims have anything to do with this foolishness that you see going on around the world, breaking the peace. There's no such thing as a righteous peace breaker. The scripture says concerning going into people's homes or people's countries. This is like what you said, you don't want nobody forcing their religious doctrines on you. I don't blame you. Because the scripture don't say do that. It says in whatsoever city or country you enter into, if they don't receive you, leave. Shake the dust off of your feet. When the people in New York didn't want that mosque or whatever it is, them people putting up that, the intelligent thing to have done is to say, okay, I understand how you feel, and I probably would feel the same way, considering what you saw. We won't put that here. Now, that's the way of peace.
That's true.
So, no, my beef ain't with you. No, my beef is with people who pretend, but they hearts tell the truth. You can always tell what's in a person's heart by what you see them do. All this talk of holy war while murdering human beings, ain't nothing holy about taking a human being's life. There's nothing holy about that. Holy war is a war of words. If you have the truth and I have a lie, but I'm believing in a lie, how is killing me going to stop me from believing in the lie? What you need to do is show me that I've been taught wrong. Now you definitely killing the lie, and you saving the soul. I ain't trying to do all the talking, Doc. You know, and I'm not telling you you was wrong for being angry. But, I mean, let's remember two wrongs don't make no right either.
Well, I think a lot of what you said, of course, I mean, if that is your opinion, then definitely concerning those matters, we would be in agreement. As I said before, of course, as a Christian and as a pastor, I believe the only way is Jesus Christ. The only way is the Bible. I believe, of course, Islam is not the correct religion. I do not believe that Muhammad was a prophet. I do not believe that he got a revelation from God. But, of course, that's a different issue. If we're talking about the religious issue, of course, I would not feel that Islam or the Qur'an is the correct word of God or the correct way.
Why do you say that?
If we're talking as an American, which I think is what we're mainly doing, or what I hear what you're doing, and of course I would definitely be in agreement, I guess, with basically everything that you said. We do not advocate the banning of the Quran. We are not against the normal civil human rights of Muslims within this country. They are protected under the First Amendment. We have absolutely no problem with them evangelizing the building of mosque. As I said, what we demand within the United States of America is that they honor and obey the Constitution. And from what I heard you say, that sounds like you are basically
want you to understand that I don't, you know, I grew up in America. I was born here, grew up here, and I'm very familiar with what is taught in the Christian faith because I grew up in that. And when I accepted Islam, it was because of what I learned from my mother growing up, that you just can't get into heaven without doing God's will. I looked up the definitions of these religions, and I found that the word itself, Islam, it means entire submission to the will of God. Now, how am I going to reject that and still claim that I believe in God? So I could not reject that. The only thing I reject is just like the Caucasians in America that truly believe in the Bible. Whether they realize it or not, if you truly believe in and practice the Bible, you are practicing the will of God. You're practicing submission to the will of God. And that is Islam. And so, you know, we don't have as much differences as you may think. And I'm not saying this out of some private thought of my own. I'm saying this because it's true. When you look at Jesus' words in the gospel, he said, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." There again, Jesus taught submission to the will of God. That is Islam. Those people over in the East, they have the right name, but that's all they got. They don't practice God's will. They practice their will superimposed over the will of God, just like most of the people in this country. They don't practice the Bible. They practice their own interpretation of the Bible. I don't do that. I don't go for if I tell you that the Bible says this and means this, I show you in the Bible that it does say that, and it shows you, and I show you that it says it means that. That way it's not me trying to get you subtly or subliminally to start worshiping me in God's place. I'm not trying to take God's place. And so my next question is, we don't disagree about your reasoning for about the burning the Qur'an. My next question is, why do you say that you don't believe the Qur'an is the word of God? What have you read in there that make you feel that way?
Well, I don't believe that the Qur'an or Islam is the correct religion because I believe the Bible is pretty clear. Jesus talked about he's the only way, he's the way, the truth, and the life. Actually, there's many issues there in the Bible. The Bible warns against someone taking away or adding to the scriptures the Quran, whether it be the Quran or the Book of Mormon or some other so-called holy book that is adding, of course, to the Bible. The Bible is clear that even if an angel of God comes to you and gives you a Qu'ran in Mississippi?
I'm in a little town called Ridley.
Oh, that's
about halfway. That's about halfway between Natchez and Vicksburg. It's a little town next to Alcorn State University. We're about 10 minutes from Alcorn State University.
Okay. What is your connection then with Detroit? Because I guess I was under the impression that you were up there in Dearborn or in Detroit.
Well, I am on the air. That's where I have broadcasts on the air there, and I go back and forth to Detroit frequently. And as a matter of fact, I just got back from Detroit. And I'll be going back again in July.
Okay.
So we are on the air there 3 times a week, teaching Islam.
Right. And you will not be there then on June the 17th when we are there.
No, sir. Unless it was necessary. Unless you think it's necessary. I mean, I am free to travel whenever I get ready.
Sure. Of course.
But I had not planned on being back there. If I was them, I would say to those who are in Dearborn to not just have you stand out there and protest. Y'all need to sit down and you express your grievances. And then whatever you are asking, that's not against righteousness, then y'all should be able to work that out. We ain't got to be at each other and everybody. Just like the, you said something about the Bible, you believe in the Bible, and the other country talking about they want to ban the Bible. There's no such thing as a person who believes in God's word talking about banning God's word. There's no such thing as that. And the second pillar of faith in Islam is that you must believe in all of the prophets and in all of their scriptures. That alone is enough to tell you that those people who are you who are listening to me besides Dr. Jones here, you who claim you are Muslim, why you don't have a Bible in your mosque when you teach it? The second pillar of faith teach you that you must believe in all of the prophets. I teach from all of the scriptures. I don't teach from one. And I don't make any distinction between the words of Muhammad or the words of Amos. Because none of them, according to them, was the author of anything they said. They say they got it from God. And I mean, whether you have a Bose speaker or some little cheap something that ain't got no name, the words that come out of there, the speaker ain't got nothing to do with that. Likewise, I recognize the word of God regardless to which prophet had it to say. If you quote the Bible to me, I'm satisfied. If you quote the Quran to me, I'm satisfied. Because I know they are all from Allah. Period. That's not something that I believe. That's something I know. The teaching of Jesus was, he said, he that is of God heareth God's words. You know, the when I read the Holy Bible and I study it, I went through so many of them, and the pages fall out of them. But I studied them, and I know that the Bible is the Word of God. It's not something that I'm stuck with just a belief on. No, I know that it's the Word of God. And I act on that. Now, I'll grant you that when I was a child, I understood it as a child, like the book says. But I'm no longer that little child and having a child's understanding of these books. I have a man's understanding. I'm that man that you heard of in the books that is called Son of Man.
who was to come at the end of this world's time. And that is who I'm telling the world that I am. And I'm not saying that in a vacuum. I'm saying that publicly. And I'm saying that if anyone can prove that I'm not that man, then I will give you $20,000. And if you like, you can bring me the pistol and I'll blow my own brains out. So you ain't got to do all that. This is not something that I'm joking about. The world that has, especially the religious world, you can tell that Satan is at the bottom of it. How you know that? Because Jesus made an observation. He said that when they accused him of casting out the devil by the power of the prince of the devil. And Jesus told them, he said, if Satan cast out Satan, then his house is divided against itself. How then shall his kingdom stand? Now, for every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. Okay, look at religion. You got people literally trying to kill other people because of their religious beliefs. You can't show me where Prophet Muhammad or Jesus or Moses or any of them ever ordered anybody to go kill somebody because they disagreed with them. And I will grant you what you said to a degree. America has practiced more Islamic doctrine than those who claim that they are Muslims over in the East. In this country, you can say you don't like the president. And you can get out there publicly and talk against it. And ain't nobody going to pay you no visit at night and you wind up dropping off the earth. They even make the president the butt of their jokes in on late night movies. What country can you go to and the leadership is so comfortable in their position that don't get you in trouble? So America has a lot to attract people. The mere fact that many of you have left your country that you claim is Muslim and that you claim is that you have God's true religion. What you leave there for to come here then? Because you don't have the freedom that you taste when you come to this country. I believe in giving justice, brother. You don't go telling me that you want to kill the goose and you ain't got another goose to replace it that's laying as good of eggs as that one you trying to kill. There's no country on the face of the earth fit to say that it's the next step in human evolvement, human evolution, as far as ideas and ideals go. No. So, none of them now can really offer us any wisdom to show that they can now guide us better. No, the guidance that is coming to the world was prepared over here in America. That's what the 400 years of slavery was for. God wanted a servant that would willingly submit to him. And so he took Abraham's seed. That's what America is. America fulfilled a prophecy in the 15th chapter of Genesis. God said to Abram, starting at the 12th verse, it says, and when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that's not theirs, and they shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. That was fulfilled with the slavery that America did to my people. And I used to be sitting up hating them for that.
But now I understand that actually it had nothing to do with the white man. It had something to do with God using them and us to produce that servant that he would use to offer salvation to the whole world. You see, the scriptures came from the east. They came from the eastern lands. But the understanding of the scriptures was produced over here in the western land. And that's what I am. I'm the answer to that prayer that Abraham and Ishmael prayed for in the Holy Quran, to raise up one who shall recite to them thy messages and teach them the book and the wisdom and purify them. By the time I finish, there's not going to be but one sheepfold and one shepherd. As it is written, I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I can't expect you, Dr. Jones, to believe in a book that you don't have no knowledge of. The Holy Quran is not the religious book that this country has. The Holy Bible is the religious book that this country has. So, I expect you to believe in that which was revealed and given to you. That is the Holy Bible. If you believe in that, then I'm satisfied. We'll come to terms on the rest of these. That's, as I believe what the Bible says. The Bible says in 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God, see, the man of God is the instructor, that the man of God may be perfect, meaning complete, thoroughly furnished unto every good work, to all good work. And so that's what I'm here to do. I'm not here to speak to you with my own words. We done had enough of that. I'm here to speak to you with the words that is in the books of God that you can check me on. If I say something that God didn't say, then it is not God that I represent. But if I say what God said before me, then you would do wise, and all of the rest of the people on this planet would be wise to listen to me.
You have a church there in your area then? A mosque?
No, sir. The way you can listen to me is through this conference line. We have a conference line and we are on the internet. See, I don't need a church now that we have all of these wonderful tools, electronic communication. The whole world now is a church.
Yep.
As you notice, the scripture says, Jesus warned you. He said in the 24th chapter of Matthew, Jesus said, don't believe people if they tell you to go here or go there. He said that this is the 24th chapter of Matthew, and I'm going to start reading at the 24th verse. He said,
Maybe when you're done there, I go ahead and share some of our points that we feel are going to be important.
I will let you do that now. Go ahead. Go ahead, Dr. Jones.
Yeah, these are... but like you said, I mean, if you have somewhat influence up there in that Dearborn area, the last time that we were up there, I don't know if you saw that on television or not. I guess it will be broadcast again this time. But we had quite a bit of trouble up there. I mean, definitely the peaceful religion that you were talking about, we definitely did not actually see it up there. We were met with quite a bit of violence. The plans this time is that we will be met with quite a bit more violence.
No, I don't condone that.
At that time, there were several hundred demonstrators there. I believe they're pretty much all of the Islamic faith. They broke through the police barrier. They threw bottles. They threw shoes at us. They were cursing us. If it had not been for the riot police, they would have definitely broken through. They definitely did not express expressions of peace. They were very, very angry. And all we were there doing, we were not attacking, actually, we were not attacking Islam. We were not attacking the Qur'an. We were not going to burn the Qur'an. We were actually doing nothing of that nature. At that particular time, we were just simply demonstrating against jihad and sharia, which I believe are two things that a normal-thinking Muslim or a normal-thinking American would actually also be against. This time, we are going to be addressing five issues that I believe that are also very valid here in America. And I believe these issues, I think probably all five of them, should be able to be pretty much in agreement on. They would be the first one I think I already mentioned, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, civil and human rights for all Muslim, Quran, governed countries, or their immediate removal from the UN. I feel this is very, very essential. After 1,400 years, as you're aware of, it's quite apparent that you're an intelligent person. You are aware, of course, of the fact that in those countries they have been killing minorities and Christians for many, many generations. We've seen those things happen just recently in Egypt. So definitely we are asking that, that those countries be forced, if that's possible, to institute laws that protect people of the Christian faith or people of no faith at all, that they might be able to live in a certain amount of security and peace without fear of being killed. The second thing that we are asking for is the immediate halting of all Muslim immigration. The reason for that is we feel that their motives need to be examined. As you are talking, it's quite apparent that you are very pro-American. I mean, you're for the Constitution. You're for the rights that the Constitution provides. But that is definitely not the case by every person who claims to be a Muslim, that we really re-examine what's happening there in our immigration area. And that actually the removal of all illegal aliens from the United States, that is definitely a problem. The United States of America, as we all know, has always been a country that has had their arms and hearts, I guess, to a certain degree, open to foreigners. But at the same time, we do have to do this in a legal way. And at this particular time, as you're probably also aware of, our problem with illegals in America has become quite disastrous. people who are actually being persecuted by Muslims in that country from immigrating to America or to other countries where more equal rights, civil rights, and freedom of speech are available. Number five, we are asking for the nationwide banning of Sharia in the United States. I guess you are aware that definitely here in America, some Muslim organizations, especially CARE and some other groups, they are definitely pushing for Sharia to be in effect, especially dealing with domestic problems, family problems, perhaps issues of inheritance, especially in those family areas and problems that would really damage or pretty much stop women's rights. So these are the five areas that we are asking the United States government or the UN to step in and do something. We think these are areas that would bring more peace and harmony in America. Let's say very especially or definitely number five, as you are aware, there is quite a bit of anxiousness, anxiety, perhaps you could even label it as fear concerning Muslims and Sharia. That has been quite the talk here lately. So definitely that would help, I believe, the American public to put their mind at ease if we saw Muslims as yourself who honor and respect the United States and want the laws of the United States to remain the Constitution. So I think number five is also something that we should be able to be in agreement with, and something that would also be quite a positive step in the area of unity between Muslims here in America.
Well, this is go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off.
Well, I'm basically done with that. I was planning on anyway about an hour, so I think we have about 10 minutes left, so go ahead and take it if you want.
Well, I unless you have to go, you don't have to go. I'm enjoying this discussion with you, and I think that some much good can come out of it. The one thing I would like you to correct, and that is that those people who are doing all of these things that are against the teachings of righteousness, you need to stop calling them Muslims. Although, no, you can refer to them as what they are. It's just like if you see a whole group of police officers, like that thing that happened in New York that they did that story of Serpico on. There were lots of crooked police officers. They were taking bribes and all of that kind of thing. And by the time it was over with, they wasn't calling them police officers anymore. They were calling them what they are, criminals. You see, as long as we label the people who are not living up to what a label means, then we give a false view of what that is. If I see a man in a policeman's uniform robbing a bank, I don't care if he does have a policeman's uniform on and badge and all of that. I don't say there's a police officer. I say there's a crook there, dressed up like a police. What did the crook look like? Well, he had on a policeman's uniform. Okay. I don't give these people who misrepresent Islam credit. The Holy Quran does not either. In chapter 49, it tells me of these. It says, the dwellers of the desert. The dwellers of the desert. Now, that tells you who that's talking about. It's talking about all of those eastern countries. Those are desert lands over there. It says, and this is the 49th chapter, and the I'll tell you in a minute. It's the 12th verse, I believe. Let me turn to it. It's the 14th verse. It says, the dwellers of the desert say, we believe. Well, that's what all of those over there in the East say. They say they believe in Islam. Then it says to me, it says, say to them, you believe not, but say we submit. You know why it tells them that they don't believe? It's because you don't know whether you believe or disbelieve in something that you have not understood. And the mere fact that all of the religious people, you've heard the term, probably heard the term Mahdi before. The term Mahdi in Arabic means rightly guided one. And they are all expecting the Mahdi to come. Well, the mere fact that they acknowledge that there's a rightly guided one coming is an acknowledgement that they don't have rightly guided ones now. They are misguided. And so I'm told to say to them, you believe not, but say we submit. When the rightly guided one comes, I have to say to them, submit. Why? That's what any teacher says to the students when they come into class. Sit down, be quiet, and submit to so I can teach you and give you understanding. And so that's what I am. I'm one who is rightly guided. In the Bible, Jesus said it like this. He said, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. That is the one that all of the books talk about coming. That's who I'm telling you I am. Now, these people that, just like you say, you don't want Muslims in the American embassy. No, you don't want hypocrites in the American embassy. That's what you should be saying. You don't want people who claim to believe in righteousness, but are practicing what they truly believe in. Murder and rape. And just like the people talk about the president sending, joining forces with the UN, or NATO, pardon me, joining with NATO in agreement to create that no-fly zone over Libya because Gaddafi, according to what the intelligence of that was shared with us, I can only go by what they shared with us, that he was over there dropping bombs on people that didn't have them but rifles. I mean, you know, when America stood by and watched Hitler do what he was doing in Europe, that's a black mark against America in the eyes of historians. So rather than stand by and watch somebody else doing that to innocent people, NATO decided to, you know, we got to do something about this. I mean, and that's what you would expect from a ruler. If you are a ruler and you're in a position to stop somebody, just like grown people in your community, if you in the community and you see people over across the street murdering their children or whatever, you have a duty to go over there and say, hey, what you doing? No, you can't do that. We're going to get some help and get you out of here and take them children from you. And that's the same with any unjust ruler. If you claim to believe in justice, in the Constitution, your belief in justice, if you say you're motivated by the noble aspects of your Constitution, then one of the things that makes a righteous man is that he loves his neighbor as himself. In Islam, it's said the same way. Prophet Muhammad said it, but it's just worded a little differently. None of you is Muslim until he loves for his brother that which he loves for himself. You see, what people don't realize is that you don't get a chance to practice righteousness really until you get up over somebody. When you get in a position of authority over people, when you get people at a disadvantage, that's when your righteousness, it's time for it to be seen.
Yeah, that's definitely what we would, I would definitely, I've said that many times. I said here maybe before I go, I can go ahead and close with this. I would definitely agree with that. That's one of the problems that we have, of course, with Islam. Because here in America, Islam, as I saw also in Europe, as I said, I lived in Europe for 30 years. And here in America, Islam proclaims itself to be a religion of peace. But they only do that as long as they are here in the minority. As they become the majority, you don't really see that. But basically saying what you have said there, I have always said that it's not, if you can understand this, it's not so important what a minority says, as long as a minority is the minority. But what a minority does when it becomes the majority, how does it then treat the minority under them? And that is actually what we do not see in Islam. We see a definite contradiction. We see the fact that here in America, Islamic leaders all through America are quoting Qur'an scriptures, of course not from the latest, but from the Mecca version. They quote Qur'an scriptures about peace and all of that. But in actually in Islamic countries, we do not actually really see that in practice.
Well, you're not seeing Islamic countries.
We feel the need to stand up and give this awareness, make people stand up, make them look at Islam. Like I said, if Islam is truly a religion of peace, then as far as the Constitution goes, then of course we have no problem with it. If they are willing to obey the laws of the land, as I have already indicated, then that is also okay. And religion, of course, and the Quran and the Islam that you have described, that is, I believe, compatible with the United States and with the Constitution. So in that particular aspect, that Islam we would not have a problem with as far as Americans under the First Amendment.
Well, Dr. Jones,
anyway,
before you go,
I've done several interviews, but it's been very nice talking to you.
Well, before you go, I would like to invite you to come back Friday so that we can continue our discussion, and we can bring about a bridge where there did not one exist. We are not trying to give you a propaganda. We are trying to show you that the people who you have thought were representing the religious doctrine to you, they have misrepresented the doctrine to you. That's what I'm sharing with you.
Yes.
And I would much rather, let's call it what it is. Just say them orthodox, those who have orthodox Islamic beliefs. Those things are 1,400 years out of date. And that Prophet Muhammad even said that Antichrist would appear among his people. And that's exactly what you got, Antichrist there. Anything that is against the teachings of any of the messengers of God, that is anti-Christ. Because the messengers of God were one brotherhood. They are one. As the book says, as the body is one and has many members, and all they being many are one body, so also is Christ. The messengers of God are one. And if the people who say they believe in the messengers of God truly believe and understood, then the people who believe in them would be one. And this is what we are trying to get the whole world to see. It's time to stop fighting and killing each other. It's time to stop disrespecting one another. The human human beings on this planet, I believe we are all from this planet.
Yeah, I understand. I think what's your point that you're trying to, and like I said, you know, maybe we can continue this sometime. Just give my office there a call, and we'll see what we can do. But I think for now I need to go ahead and go. But thank you very much. It's been a very good conversation. And yeah, definitely that is a different type of Islam than what we have ever heard before. So again, thank you very much, and maybe we will talk again in the future.
I look much forward to it, Dr. Jones.
All right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. You know, he don't sound like he's a crazy man to me. You know, people sometimes are forced into doing things, you know, that you don't know what made them do that. That's why it's good to ask people, why you do this? I mean, I would give this advice to those in Dearborn. If you are truly trying to show the world that Islam is the true religion of God, and stop trying to cram it down people's throats. Do you realize that the true religion of God is the most valuable thing on this planet or in this universe? More valuable than gold. Now who, if they had a reservoir full of gold, would go around trying to force people to take some? Wouldn't you just offer it? And if they don't want it, then they're going to stay poor, huh? But I guarantee you, if they know it's gold, you won't have to beg them to take it long once they find out that you really got something that's worthwhile. You know, you're sitting up here talking about you want to get rid of America, for instance. Y'all ain't got nothing better to replace it with. Some little petty, self-important dictator. That your answer to everybody who disagree with you is kill them. We done been there, we did that. We done seen where that lead to. It don't make no difference how many people house a foolish mind. You see them as many. I see them as one. Just one big foolish mind that's done took up residence in billions of people. A sixth grade education is a sixth grade education. It don't make no difference how many people you pass it around to. All of them together don't add up to but the sixth grade. And one 12th grader is more powerful than all of them put together. So you needn't think that because you outnumber me, that means something. That don't mean nothing to me. Because I have as my friend and my protector and my help Almighty God Allah and all of the holy angels. They're all with me. And you see how civilized he was? What was bigoted about him? No, your problem is because you don't really understand what you are about or understand what you're preaching to other people, the minute somebody disagrees with something you say, you're ready to jump on them. Because their disagreement manifests that you ain't about nothing. I told you, anybody who will talk to me, if they talk to me long enough, I'll convert them. You let him keep talking to me until pretty soon. He already said the Islam I got, he can deal with. What is that saying? I'm not the problem. me let you hear something here. Give me a minute. I forgot I hit pause. Just a moment.
For us, called pain, the country club, for making it possible, we want to thank the Chicago white people for making it possible for us to obtain the country club, for making it possible for us to get in such position where we can prove ourselves worthy of this position.
Yes, sir.
We thank them. They have did us a great favor.
Yes, yes, sir.
I don't think that we have nothing to do but to honor and thank them for putting us in such position.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Mr. Foster.
This is their house. And we are here teaching the truth.
Yes, sir.
That's right. That's right.
They're not objecting to you teaching the truth. As we have white Muslims in America. And lots of them. We have them all over the world.
Yes, sir.
And they recognize and respect you.
That's right. Go ahead, dear
Father. You must recognize and respect them.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now you just saw an example of what he was talking about. You got these people running around the earth building mosques to cause harm to Islam. They ain't never been tried. They were never trying to spread their religious doctrine before the Nation of Islam rose up. Now all of a sudden, everywhere you look, they jumping out there misrepresenting what Islam is about. Why? Because, I mean, let's face it, man. Any fool know that you ain't going to make no convert when you are offending people. I mean, Jesus called it fishing. He said, come and follow me, I will make you fishers of men. And he said, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents, but what? Harmless as doves. He didn't say, strap a bomb to yourself and go blow as many of them, take yourself with them, fool. That's what you have to be, a fool. To believe that a man who would condone you committing suicide is somehow from God. If he thinks you're going to get such a great reward, tell him you strap it on you and go do it then. See you, wouldn't want to be you. Do you understand? So, brothers and sisters, you listen to what the messenger says. He even talks about them having their flag.
You don't disrespect people that
is fine to respect you.
Yes, sir.
I remember the last time that I was out to the airport. They let me and my followers get on first.
Yes, sir.
Now, remember that flag is still flying over America.
Yes, sir.
Honor and respect the man.
Yes, sir.
Because he still have his flag.
Did he say go burn their flag? Or did he say respect to me? Huh? And he also went on to say, he said, there's much that can be interchanged between us and them in that way of respect. And we have a flag too. Don't you want people to respect your flag and what it stands for? Well, then why do you think that you should go and burn theirs? No, we don't think that. It's just like somebody who don't care. This world is full of people like this. They feed their family fine. They love to have plenty of money coming in fine. They love it so much that they'll even rob you out of what's rightfully yours so they can have an overabundance. I'm gonna talk about something in a minute, but I want you to hear the rest of this.
There's much that can be interchanged between them and us in that way of respect.
Yes, sir.
We don't have to get up to try to make fun of them just because you have learned yourself. And now you have learned them.
Yes, sir. That's right, Apostle.
Just remember.
Yes, sir.
That they show you respect after you have learned yourself. Too.
Yes, sir.
Because when you didn't know yourself, you didn't respect self nor anyone else.
That's right. Oh,
right. We used to disgrace ourselves and them too.
That's right.
Because we didn't know ourselves.
Yes, sir.
But now, we respect ourselves and we respect it.
Yes, sir.
Praise be to Allah.
Yes, sir.
You'll go out there disrespecting the honor of this land. They are alone, as long as they're in power.
Yes, sir.
I think you will be showing disrespect for the high honor that has been conferred on you.
Yes, sir.
And me, by God.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, dear Holy Father.
Yes, sir.
Respect everybody. And everybody will respect you.
Right. Right.
Thank you.
That's what I'm trying to get you to practice. Allah didn't raise us up and give us wisdom so we could go make fun of people and do things purposely to aggravate people. If that's what you're doing, you didn't learn nothing from the 400-year experience of being ridiculed, mocked, kicked around, denied freedom, justice, and equality. You should have learned something. We all should have learned something from that. We should have learned that it don't feel good. We should have learned that if we was done like that and it didn't feel good when we was done like that, and we not going to do that to nobody. Sitting up purposely saying things to hurt people's feelings. I'm not telling you to lie on people or lie for people. If a man is wrong, you should tell him so. But at the same time, you can't tell that man he's wrong when you provoke the action that you see. You do something to provoke someone to act other than right. And then when they retaliate, then you ready to cry foul. No, you wrong. Muslims are not aggressors on anyone. Muslims are peaceful people. Muslims are people who, wherever they go, good follows them. Goodness and mercy follows them. How I know? Because I'm a Muslim. Let that one come in here and say that I came around them and broke their peace and did harm to them and they hope they never see me again or whatnot. I ain't did nothing to none of you but tried to help you. And if I couldn't help you, I left you alone. Now, how many of y'all can say that? So, we have much to do and learn in order to show people what Islam truly is. But the first thing I had to do was get out here and correct this stuff that you've been seeing in the news, talking about Muslim terrorists. Muslim did this, Muslim did that. There's no Muslim commit terrorism. Don't no Muslim do that. Why don't you call them what they are? Just call them terrorists. Trying to disguise themselves as Muslims. I'm telling you, you're wrong for even putting them out there and saying that Muslims is this. We are the Muslims. The first Muslims you met in this country was the Nation of Islam. When had you ever seen us practicing terrorism? But then don't be calling them people terrorists, Muslim terrorists. A Muslim is a righteous person. A Muslim is one who submits to God. Look it up in your dictionary. Now, how do you fix your mouth to say Muslim terrorists? Don't call them hypocrites what they are. Terrorists disguising themselves or trying to disguise themselves as Muslims. Now, that's what you call it. In a few days, you ain't gonna have to worry about it no way. Because Allah ain't melting all that ice from the solar, from the Arctic Circle, for nothing. He's melting it so he can use it. You see how hot it is now? You know why it's so hot? You know all that water that was rain and all that snow and stuff that was dropped down? It's being drawn back up quickly. Getting ready to use it on you again. Don't worry. Yeah, you'll see it again. It's going to get cool again. It's going to get downright cold. Don't you worry. He don't run out of arms. No, sir. Drop it down, draw it back up, and drop it on him again. Like I said, I'm not by myself. Allah and all his angels is with me. All the holy angels. Yes, sir. And all of you who run around here misrepresenting what a Muslim is, you're going to wish with all that was in you that you had just went on and declared yourself to be what you truly are instead of trying to make mockery of us. As I said, I speak for all Muslims. And you notice the things I say, ain't nobody disagree with. Come in here and show me what I said that's wrong. I want to say to those who are the oil people, all of you wealthy people who are over the oil industry. I want to show you something. And I hope that Mr. or Dr. Jones, I hope Dr. Jones you make sure you call his people tomorrow and let's set up a series where we can do away with this misunderstanding of what Islam is so that he will understand that if he's practicing what's in the Bible, he's Muslim. When you practice the word of God, you are a Muslim. You're not no Christian. The Bible and the Holy Qur'an are Muslim scriptures. And I will prove that to you if we talk a while. I'm not here to try to brainwash you, but I am here to wash your brain. You can't purify nothing if you don't wash it. So the book said they have washed their robes and made them white. Your robes is your thoughts. That's what you mean. You put a robe on, don't you? How many times have you said to a person, what's on your mind? Well, I'm going to wash your robes. Make them white in my blood. But I want to get to this before we get off here. I've been wanting to remind, I see things that getting ready to happen. And I got to tell you, so that it won't be my fault. But you got some people who I don't care how much they get. It ain't enough. They can have enough to last them whole lifetime. Ain't enough. Huh? And so I want you to turn to the book of Luke, the 12th chapter. Go to the 12th chapter of Luke, and we're going to start reading at the 16th verse. It says, and he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. He got so much that he done filled up his box and still got more. He says, then he said to himself, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater ones. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. Now notice, when he first built them barns, he was wishing he could have enough to fill them up. He had to be. He built them big enough to, if he filled them up, he figured that'd be enough, right? But when they got full, what did he say? What am I going to do now? Not once did he say, I think I will share the rest of this with the poor. Oh, no. Uh-uh. No, I'm going to build a bigger barn. He said. And he says, and there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take it easy. Take thine ease. Huh? Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasures for himself and is not rich toward God. Huh? Now I'm going to talk to the oil people again. Every one of you is filthy rich. Owners of Exxon, BP, Shell, you name it. All of you got plenty. And you see people, you know, what is minimum wage now? 7 and a quarter? Won't even buy you 2 gallons of gas. Man got to drive to work and spend most of his money on the tank. If he was making minimum wage, all he's getting is enough to drive to go back and forth to work. I'm telling you now. Well, they need more. They telling their stockholders, we making a killing. Well, I'm telling you, if you don't stop it, you might have plenty of money. You ain't gonna have no mind to go with it. That's one way to make sure that you can't tell somebody to go and rob the poor no more. When you can't think to do it. Now, I'm warning you. I've seen the gas prices go down a little bit on my way back here, but it's still too much. $3.45 for regular gas and all of that. You put that back down to $1.50, $1.40. You put it back down to where people can buy them 5 or 6 gallons of gas on 1 hour's pay. The poor man can buy. If you won't do that, watch what I tell you. You're going to learn to fear this one. Remember Isaiah said, let him be your fear and let him be your dread. Okay. You ain't got to change it. You better send them gas prices back down so that poor people don't suffer so much. And so that the truckers can deliver their goods and the stores can go down. And you store owners, when that gas price go down, you go down on the price of this stuff. Now, if you don't do this now, I'm telling you now, what's been happening? You saw an example with Howard Hughes. Well, it was over with. He was so paranoid, he couldn't eat meat. I'm warning you. Correct the situation before it get out of your hand, and you can't correct nothing. Alright, you can believe me or not, I done told you. You see right here, that rich fella said in his heart, he didn't think about the poor. He was thinking about where to put it so he could have plenty more. Huh? You talking to you listening to a man who ain't never got excited about money. And the more I get, the more I give away. It ain't no big thing to me. I don't care nothing about no money. I wasn't raised up for that. Not that I'm saying that I don't need money. I know you need money. Money answers everything in this society. They put up them school buildings on no crap. You need some money. But I don't know how any of you can sit up there wealthy and have plenty and look at all the poverty around you and not, I know you don't know what to do. Bring it to me and I will show you what to do. Every time you look up, somebody taking up money for this cause or that cause, it ain't nothing changing. You putting your charity in the wrong hands. Put it in my hands and I will show you what should have been being done with it. This man, what's his name? That boy name that just paid $25 million to make the lawsuit go away? What's his name? That fella there in, where's he at, in Atlanta? That preacher that stand up in his body shirts. Eddie Long. He got $25 million to pay to make a lawsuit go away. What are you doing with that kind of money? And people, just, I tell you what he's doing, stealing. I don't know how mad you get. You take money from the poor, what you doing with it? Buying jets and big houses and summer houses and you name it. And all of them upholding each other in their wrongdoing. Old Cleflo Dollar and all of them. You know it. Tell them I'm talking about. Someone's coming now that you love money. Come get that $20,000 that's on a man offering for showing him he lying. I'm telling you, do you imagine what kind of money these people making off of gas when regular gasoline in my lifetime, and I ain't but 60 years old. And I remember when regular gasoline was 14 cents a gallon. 14 cents, man! Minimum wage was a dollar and a quarter. You could fill your tank up and get change back off of a dollar. Minimum wage didn't keep up with the cost of gasoline. That ratio don't exist no more. I'm telling you, y'all robbing people. It don't take no rocket scientist to figure that out. Huh? How many times will 14 cents go into $4 and $4? How many times? Approximately 30 times. Now, if back then they was paying $5 or $4 a barrel for oil, and now they're paying, what, $90? How many times will four go into 90? Approximately how much? Approximately 23 times. Okay. Well, if even by that standard, the gas price shouldn't have went up no 30 times when they didn't, the cost of oil didn't go up that much. And they was making a killing back then. You know how we know? Everybody that drive a car, they selling gas to the military, they selling gas to everybody on the planet. How's he hurting? You robbing the people. I'm warning you. That little tightness that you're feeling in your head right now, just to show you that my word carries some weight now. You don't change, you're going to see lots of crazy rich people walking around. You'll take me serious after a while. You ain't going to beg you to do nothing. But this stuff that you got going here, the filthy rich and the dirt pole, that stuff in the stock. A few little greedy crooks hogging all the resources on the planet. In the first place, ain't no oil company got no business owning the mineral rights to the oil in America when it comes to stuff like that, it belongs to the whole country. I notice he ain't going out there when somebody attacks the country. He ain't the only one fighting for it. Everybody that's in the military, everybody in the country fight for it. So all of the natural resources of the country belong to the country. The government should be in control of that, and that is the people. Whatever revenues come from it should go to benefit the whole people. Because it's the whole people's country. You ain't think just because the people don't know. That don't mean that what you're doing is right. Simply because the people don't know that you ain't got no right to be owning all of the oil on the property. Yeah, let me tell you something. Even the oil that people find on their land, it's stretching out over under other people's land, too. It ain't just all his, but he claimed it. Are you mad at me now? Get mad all you want. You ain't nobody as mad as I'm getting. This ain't your planet. The book said the earth is the Lord. And the fullness thereof, the world and everybody in it. My teacher told me before he left here, he said the earth belonged to you. He said it didn't belong to you, but now you the true owner. Israel taking it away from you. He said, come on, I want to give it back to you. And since it's mine, I'm telling you, you share the profits with what you getting. You don't need no more money. You got all the money that you could possibly ever want or need. You pass some of that wealth on to the little people. You do that, and you will never find yourself ever needing anything ever again in your life. Help the poor. And I promise you, you will never regret it. Things will open up for you that you never dreamed would come simply because you opened your pocket when I asked you to help me to help the people. Ask them who've been giving me. Ask them. Maybe sometime when we have time, I will let the people call up and who's been donating. You ask them how much they've been hurting. since they've been giving me my tithe. Ain't missed nothing you gave me. Because fast as you giving it, I'll all giving you some more. That's right. Through me and other people. I know that's right. Allah softened people's heart to help you when you help me. And everybody gets blessed. That's what I'm here for. I want to see all of you get blessed. That's right. I don't want the rich man to become a poor man. That's not what I'm after. I want him to stay rich. I just want that now that he got it here, now help others. That's all I'm saying.
There are 3 moderators and 77 participants on the call.
So we want to go on and get into these discussions like we had this evening. You know, I wanted to show Dr. Jones that everybody who says their religion is Islam is not a fool. And there is no religious doctrine on this earth equal to the religion of Islam. When you get in conversation with me about what I teach and about what you teach, you find out that which you thought was Christianity or some other thing, that's Islamic teaching. That ain't had nothing to do with that stuff you talking about. Now, I repeat, I speak for Muslims, and I'm the only spokesperson for Muslims. Do anybody disagree with that? There you are. And why shouldn't I speak for the Muslims? You let me go on and do what I'm supposed to do, and everywhere you go, people will open their doors to you because they will know that you are a just and righteous person and they have nothing to fear from you. But to mistreat you, they fear to do that because you're not the one they got to answer to if they mistreat you. They have to answer to the God who told you to be harmless. They got to answer to the God who told you to treat people like you want to be treated. He didn't say as men do to you, do that to them. He told you have a right to retaliate. Says eye for eye, tooth for tooth. He said, but whoever foregoes that, it shall be an expiation for you. That means that's an atonement for some of the wrong you've been doing. And you remember it says, if you forgive, your Heavenly Father will forgive you. Forgive us our debts. As we forgive those who owe us, as we forgive our debtors. But what if you don't forgive nobody? You're not going to be forgiven. Do you understand? All right, remember that. So, now, you say, well, what if the wealthy people didn't hear you? That ain't my fault. What if you sleeping and the alarm go off over there at the nuclear plant? Huh? That ain't their fault. They sounded it. If you didn't hear it, sorry. Guess it wasn't meant. Remember now, God told Moses, go warn Pharaoh. But I ain't gonna let him pay you no attention. I'm gonna harden his heart. Huh? Man, that's a terrible thing when God decides that you got a punishment coming, but he gonna warn you and then they ain't gonna let you hear. Huh? Yeah, I'm gonna fix him. That's what Allah said. I'm gonna show you what I'm gonna do to Pharaoh. Just in case some other ones, he had to put that in there to show you that, I know you don't hear me. You won't hear me. Don't want to hear me. You'll notice, he didn't tell me he don't believe I'm the Son of Man. He didn't even want to stick around and talk to me long about religion because that was taking the fight out of him that he got to go do. I'm here for peace, man. I'm not here to help you go and keep on keeping foolishness going. If those people, you hear what he said he was expecting to meet when he go up there? He expecting violence. Do that sound like he thinks that he's going to talk to righteous people? Or going to demonstrate against somebody that's right? No. He's manifesting. See, these people ain't got no righteousness in their heart. Look at them. That's what he's showing. He got no problem with nothing we teaching. Huh? No. You can't have no problem with what I'm teaching unless you got a problem with the scripture. That's why you can't find nobody come in here and want to argue. Allah said, Son of Man, speak with my words to him. I will give him a mouth and wisdom that none of his enemies will be able to gainsay nor resist. This is to him that he was talking about. You better be glad it's Wednesday. Because I could keep it going the way I feel right now. And for all them who was waiting on us to get in an insulting match, well, that's not what I'm here for. I can make peace with anybody that will talk to me. And I don't have to lie and pretend to believe something I don't believe. Peace based on a lie is no peace at all. Do you understand? So, I want to let you hear something here. This little sister show enough song this song. Yeah. Let me see here. And give me a minute.
And now to honor America, especially the brave men and women serving our nation in the Persian Gulf and throughout the world, please join in the singing of our national anthem. The anthem will be followed by a flyover of F-16 jets from the 56th Tactical Training Wing at MacDill Air Force Base and will be performed by the Florida Orchestra under the direction of Maestro Yaha Ling and sung by Grammy Award winner Whitney Houston.
And when you looked at that audience, everybody out there had an American flag in their hand waving. That's what they flag mean to them. And you expect them to be happy with you to see you burning their flag. You don't make peace with people by doing that. If the Holy Quran says, Allah, let's read it here. It's not something that I make up. I'm not making up nothing. I'm showing you the truth here. Let's see here. Turn to the fourth chapter of the Holy Quran and the 148th verse. I'm going to let you go. But I want to show you something. It says, Allah loves not the public utterance of hurtful speech, except by one who has been wronged. And Allah is ever hearing and knowing. Okay. If Allah loves not the public utterance, for you to open your mouth and say something, what about the public act of doing something that hurts people? You'll notice, when them planes hit the building and the American people thought they was under attack and saw them people over there publicly clapping and praising that. How do you suppose that made the people feel? So then people want to retaliate, right? Then when you retaliate, how you think it makes them feel? Well, we're going to get you back. When does it stop? Let me show you something. Turn to the book of Romans. Chapter 12. Turn to Romans chapter 12 and let's go to verse 16. Be of the same mind, one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. See, that's why I was going to talk to Dr. Jones' name about it. You cannot claim righteousness if you follow people in evil. They do evil, so you turn around and do something that's evil too. You can't do that. You don't repel evil. That's like trying to put out fire with gasoline. You can't put fire out with gasoline. You got to put fire out with water. Or with something that does not have the nature to be fuel for that fire. Huh? When people wrong you, and you don't wrong them back, now they have no justification for what they did, especially if they wasn't justified in the first place. Now they're hoping you will do something that will give them their justification to make them feel better and be able to sleep. Do you understand? Well, as it says, recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. Huh? Okay. Go to 1 Thessalonians. The fifth chapter. Go to the 15th verse. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said it like this. He said, we don't want our people acting unrighteous, regardless to who acts unrighteous towards us. We must not do so ourselves, since we represent ourselves as being righteous people. We be righteous. That's right. So, as I told you, I mean, a lot of your government people who was trying to overthrow the Nation of Islam, they couldn't find no fault in the Nation of Islam, so they had to go find an Islam that they could find fault in. That's why they went over there and got with their buddies over there. Brought them out into the public and say, look at these Muslims. They doing this and they doing it. How come you don't say, look at the Nation of Islam? How come you didn't say, look at us? You can't find no fault in what we teach, nor what we do. We have lived in this country since 1930, and they have always found, even after they persecuted us, threw us in prison and everything else, they found us to be righteous people. We never lifted up arms with any people against this government, and we never would. In the first place, I don't need to go get no government outside of America to try to help me fight America. Allah is sufficient to help me. You're going to find that out in a minute. Yeah, a whole lot of people found that out here in Mississippi who thought they was going to persecute and mistreat me. Yeah. So, we're not here to do you harm. We're here to invite you to repent of your wrong so that Allah can bless you, so that Allah can bless us. If you don't want the blessing, well, as is written, the messenger said it. He said, Allah came to do you good. If you will not accept the good, he will do you evil. That's the only thing left. If you know, turn the other cheek means quite a few things. If your enemy smites you on the right cheek, turn to him the other one also. If you don't accept the good, the right cheek, God will return the other one to you. Telling you, you better accept the good that you've been offered. You see the snow done melted, the Arctic Circle there is getting smaller and smaller. They say it's getting so small the polar bears is becoming an endangered species. Huh? What did that tell you? That tell you war, man. But you can't shoot these soldiers. Them raindrops and them softball-sized hailstones. Look at that tornado that went through Joplin, was hiding behind rain. They didn't know, they didn't even know it till it was too late. It was concealed. Threw up some stuff. You just witnessed in the beginning. You never thought you'd see hundreds of tornadoes striking in one day. Huh? Now, how did all of them miss Jefferson County, Mississippi? Mississippi got some. How come it didn't come here? Inquiring minds want to know. Yeah. I notice you ain't so fast on the lip no more, all you smart Alex that was out there always talking crazy to me. I told you I wasn't going to have to take that from you forever. You know, even in tennis, you get to serve, and after a while, the other person gets to serve. Huh? All right. So I'm looking for the ones who think that I'm teaching wrong. Them's the one I want to talk to. I don't want to hear from y'all who telling me, son of man, I like what you're saying, or son of man, I don't need to hear that. I want to hear the one that don't like what I'm saying. I want to know why. People say, that man don't speak for Moosin. I want to know why. Come in here and tell me why I don't speak for Moosin. And tell me why you do. And let me see if you speak for Moosin. Because I know the prophets was Muslim. And I want to see if you speak for them. I'm speaking for them. They even asked me, said, Lord, how long, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them on earth? And last I heard, the Son of Man is Lord. According to them, that's what they say, the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath day. They said, know ye that the Lord, he is God. John said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. I am the beginning. And then, and saith who? In the beginning, Son of Man, take the book and eat it up. In the beginning, I am the beginning. Oh, yeah, I told you, we made the Word to have many connections. It have many meanings. I don't think I'm done talked enough. Y'all need to go. And I'm going to let you go. May Allah continue to bless us all, keep us safe and in our right mind. You get his people to commit to another date. Okay? And then we will get in here and discuss religion. Now that we done got it cleared up why he was talking about burning the Qur'an. See, it wasn't about the Qur'an. It was about getting back at them for burning their flag. Huh? So, what you need to do is they should offer the man an apology. You know, apologize to the man for the foolishness of some of your countrymen. You know. So, I'm going to tell you something. All these conflict and everything, I could put a stop to it overnight if they get in a room somewhere and I talk to all of them. I put a stop to all that food. Out here inflaming the minds of, you know, immature minds. You know, that's bad if somebody coming in, hey, nigga, and everybody get mad. You know, you usually could get black people really huffed up, you call them, especially if you was a white man. You'll say, nigga, and everybody go to pieces. You remember the poor man that said, them some nappy head, and man, and they fired the poor man. and he was just saying what he heard Johnson say. What the nappy head, Yeah, agent. And, you know, I guess can't fix my mouth. But that's how they say it. And then they made all that to do about it. You know. So I'm telling you, if you want to bury that word, stop being what that word means. Huh? All right, then. Stop being stingy, stop being selfish and all that, and the word niggered won't even apply to you no more. And so people will pretty soon feel pretty cheap calling you nigga. I can't nobody say that about me with no straight face. I'm not no nigger. I'm one of the most free-hearted people you ever want to meet. So, but like I said, you know, wanting to jump on somebody because they said something you didn't like. That's the child's mentality. That's not an adult mentality. If a man says something, you ought to want to, what makes you say that? That's the next question. What makes you say that? Then make him explain. You put him on the spot then. He can't say and still sound intelligent. I just did that to insult you. Oh, I understand. There. You know. you understand. You know, when people act like a child, you know, and you realize that you're dealing with a child's mind, then what you going to do, get in an insult match with a child? No. You tell him, well, you know, we're not going to go there. You know, we got to come up. We got to do better than that. One of us got to have some sense. Huh? Hey. All right. Stop being reactionary. You notice you can have an empty room and you say, hey, and you'll hear an echo in the room. Put furniture and stuff in and you won't hear no echo. The signal gets broken up there. It's not reactionary anymore. Put some wisdom in your head and you won't be reactionary. Because you got something going on in there. And so that foolishness don't bounce around in there and echo back and forth to you. So I'm not going to echo nobody's foolishness. Do you understand? All right. May Allah bless us all and keep us safe and in our right minds. And I hope that you wealthy people that's listening take that warning that I gave you seriously. I really don't want to see none of them suffer that. But that's what's knocking on your door now. That's what time it is. Allah, salamu alaykum.